The views and opinions expressed in the following program are those of the hosts and guests, and not necessarily those of the staff or management of Worldwide Digital Broadcasting Corporation.
Knowledge is power, and this is Powerful Stuff. Wellness Education Cannabis Advocates of Nevada present the Weekend 702 Nevada Cannabis News Hour with the Weekend Radio Team. For the next 60 minutes, we'll take an in-depth look at the cannabis reform revolution sweeping the nation. Now, let's fire up the News Hour. Here is the Weekend Radio Team.
Good afternoon. Welcome to the Nevada Cannabis News Hour. I'm your host for the day, Perry Haichu, and this is my co-host, Mike McAuliffe. And
hi there.
Here we are to talk about another fantastic year of cannabis news.
Yeah, and it's amazing how much there is and how much change there is going on around the world, and there's a lot happening here in Nevada in the past few weeks too. So we've got a few different things for you here from Nevada, and we're starting off with the fact that we reported on the show a couple of weeks back that there was a breach of the state medical marijuana site up at the Nevada Division of Health, and they took the site down for a bit, and then they brought it back up a week later, and it's gone down again, and
I'm not sure if it's still is it still down?
No, the site is back up now. What I was looking at the other night, last night I should say, as I was looking at this story, I dug back a little more, and apparently the first breach happened on December 8th, and the state noticed a problem, undisclosed problem, that was identified, and they're saying that in that breach there were no patient records that were compromised, no employee records, nothing like that, and so they took a look at this thing, and they decided to go ahead and restore the portal on December 15th. And the portal is important because this is what the dispensaries were using in order to see if the patients were legitimate and they could buy their medicine at these at the dispensaries. So it came back on, and then just a few days later, it went back down again because although the private patient information is considered secure, anyone who is an owner, an employee, anyone
or an
who
applicant
is applied exactly has their full unredacted applications are available online or worse. So it was a breach by the state. That data has gotten out, and there's a website called daily.com, and they said that they actually tested out Google searches, fairly simple searches, to find the PDFs that had these applications, and they wound up calling people up and saying, hey, did you apply for a job at a dispensary in Nevada? And they were like, yes, I did. And so
that's pretty scary.
That is pretty scary. So all these people information is out there, and if it's unredacted, it's got any arrest data, it's got social security financial data, and
that's pretty sensitive information, man. I mean, a lot of these high net worth individuals who did these applications don't want their personal information out there, where they live, where their kids go to school and things like that. That's not okay. And unfortunately, I saw this on one of our local city councilmen's Facebook pages, who broke the story, and that's how I became aware of it over the weekend. And I was questioning him. I said, look, you know, what happens now? And he's like, look, your recourse is basically limited because the state has very limited liability when it comes to issues like this. So, you know, sorry to just kind of give you the bad news, but it is what it is, and that's kind of where we are.
It is a term called qualified immunity, and these different officials acting in their official capacity are therefore indemnified from the vast majority of lawsuits.
Well, there's I've been led to believe that there might be a surplus of funds within the medical marijuana program in the budget and things like that. Well, I heard they're going to take a loan out of that to get the recreational going. But regardless, they might want to consider reallocating some of those funds to do some IT security. Yeah, sure, of course. You know,
I would think so. Because according to what the RJ says here on December 28th, that Social Security numbers, dates of birth, addresses, even driver's licenses information for people who applied for medical marijuana dispensary licenses, as well as for their employees, were made public on the net and discovered Wednesday. So this is something that has the potential for causing identity theft on a lot of these people, and there really seems to be nothing that we can do as individuals, as you say, to go after the state. The best that could be done is if you have made an application for one of these places, go in and check your credit sites and get to the three major credit reporting sites and take a look at what's going on in your account and keep an eye on it over the next few months, because it's you could find yourself a victim otherwise. And yeah, it is the state's liability here that they let this happen to people, and yet we seem to have no recourse.
Absolutely. They were the ones who demanded such high qualifications and so much information, and mm-hmm. they were the ones who demanded mm-hmm. all this, and they're the ones who decided to put it in their databases and give it to this department who was hacked. It's 100%
and so
their liability.
They assumed responsibility for this, for the sanctity of that data, and they failed on that obligation to people who entrusted them with it.
No doubt about it.
So it's a shame to see these things.
We're just going to hope that this doesn't happen again to the recreational applicants 2-3 years down the line. We hear that mm-hmm. all the recreational applicants mm-hmm. got, you know, their stuff hacked or whatever. What's the ramifications of this? You know, only time will tell individually.
And you have to wonder, who is it that's making this dedicated hack into the Nevada medical marijuana program? I can't believe it's the federal government. Is it a Russian team or a bunch of Bulgarian capitalists looking to make their own money? Or, as Donald Trump says, some 400-pound guy sitting on his couch?
All the above, potentially. You never know.
Yeah.
You never know.
We really don't. But if you have applied for employment at any of these places, just check your credit reports.
Yeah,
keep an eye on
protect
things.
Yourself.
Keep an eye and protect yourself. All right. Also, here in Nevada, take this one. Terry?
I'm surprised. I haven't heard about this on any of the news agencies or mm-hmm. in the RJ or anything, but apparently, according to the Las Vegas Sun, a Las Vegas medical marijuana dispensary, their operations have been suspended by the Nevada Department of Health and Human Services for supposedly unpaid taxes. Showgrow Las Vegas at 4850 South Fort Apache on Fort Apache in Tropicana had their license suspended recently, and they opened this June or past June. Mm-hmm. Excuse me, it's no longer this June.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I'm going to have to get used to that. Let's see. In a statement issued to the Sun on Thursday night, Showgrow Chief Executive Officer David Barakech said the dispensary suspension was a result of a clerical reporting error between Showgrow and the Nevada Department of Health and Human Services. Must have been quite a
reporting error.
Quite an error, yeah. I mean, it's just one of those things. I mean, we could go ahead and say, maybe the department is looking to yank licenses, or you know, maybe this is the county exerting pressure on the department now that the reissuing of the licenses is coming up in the not-too-distant future, or maybe this is just standard operating procedure. But this is the first, at least that I've heard of, it could have happened before, but mm-hmm. of a licensed dispensary having any sort of suspension issued whatsoever for any reason.
Well, I know of another facility who had its license suspended last spring for a few days, and it was the cultivation license in that case that was suspended.
Mm-hmm.
And so they corrected whatever their deficiencies were, and they got going again, and so they're still out there. As far as Showgrow here, they're saying that it's a paperwork issue, mm-hmm. that the infraction came as a result of the wrong paperwork being submitted to the state by a lawyer representing us.
They just said the spokeswoman from the Department of Behavioral Health and Human Services says they can't disclose the reason for suspension, citing privacy.
Mm-hmm.
And they have, what, three dispensaries in California also?
Yes,
in addition
yes.
to the one
and,
they operate here?
And I went onto the Showgrow website just before the show looking to see whether there was any news of whether they had reopened or not. But I see nothing about this one way or mm-hmm. the other there. I do see that they were still closed as of this past Friday, so I'm sure they'll be opening up soon, and we'll see. But the point that you mentioned earlier is true. I do hear it through some of my back channel discussion that the state is looking to show that they're not just pushovers, and that they're looking for several places that they can drop the hammer on just to show that they are a regulatory body with teeth, I guess.
If they would drop the hammer on liquor stores that sold to minors, there would be barely any in this town.
There you go. There you go. So, anyways, so you can check with Shogo in a few days, and I'm sure.
Yeah, if you're a patient, I'm sure they'll be back online in no time. Hopefully.
All right. Let's see. Also, in Nevada, I came across a couple of stories in the RJ here, and we talked about this a little while ago. And the first one is posted January 1st in the RJ by Wesley Jewell, and it's entitled Recreational Marijuana May Be Legal Now, But Driving While High Is Not. As if it was at some point. And the first line of the article here, gotta warm the cockles of my heart here. Metro police officers are ready to crack down on drivers high on marijuana now that recreational use of the drug is legal throughout Nevada. Okay, so all these police who pulled up all this overtime for all these years going in and busting up a grow, going in and finding, you know, somebody in a car and have a baggie of weed and processing them through and all that sort of stuff.
Gotta find something else to do now.
So now instead, now that the people have said this should be legal, they're going to be out there poised, you know, with binoculars looking at every car that goes past to see the one with the joint in it.
Well, they'll just be looking to push through a swab test, mm-hmm. or some kind of cannabis breathalyzer, or just some mm-hmm. way that they can imply impairment without actually proving it during the legislature, which is very disappointing. I was conversing with you before the show, and it just kind of came to my mind recently that the department or the various police departments throughout the state mm-hmm. seem to send their various lobbyists to the legislature for various reasons.
Absolutely.
Throughout these sessions. And what came to my mind was when I was younger and I was getting, you know, I got hemmed up for a possession charge, and the police officer in a smart ass tone says, well, we don't make the laws, we just enforce them. Mm-hmm. So if that's true, then why are they spending all these, you know, all this money for these taxes that they're, you know, they're constantly raising our taxes to pay for more cops? Is it to, in fact, pay for lobbyists for the creation of criminal activity that's nonviolent in order to protect their revenue stream?
Well, the first duty of any bureaucracy is to protect the bureaucracy. And so in arguing for some of these laws and changes, you would think it's for public safety. And to some degree, I'm sure it is. However, in the case of, I think, marijuana laws, they are protecting, rather than the public safety, they're protecting police overtime, and they're protecting the ability to make easy arrests and boost their numbers.
I had a friend who was telling me about this as a reason for him not to vote for it in California. He's like, well, they're just going to find another reason to hem us up anyway. And I'm like, look, you know, if that's the truth, then you just got to look for a way to cut their legs out from under them on that too. If they're going to come after us for this, we got to find a way to go after them about it and try to put the clamps down on that. We can't just give up and have that defeatist attitude.
I agree, and that's the same argument and actually the same correct response that the prohibitionists were making earlier last year against legalization initiatives, where they were where it was shown that 60% of the money that was coming into Mexican drug cartels came from marijuana. And the idea is that if you legalize it, you're cutting the legs out from under them. You're cutting that revenue stream. And the prohibitionists were saying at that time, oh, it doesn't matter. If you legalize marijuana, then they're just going to do something else illegal and they'll still
have the
money.
Then we'll go after them for that.
Right. And exactly what? So fine, you find another way to go after them. But the idea that they're still going to be there, if you're freeing up resources from not going after after end users, you're going to be able to target the hardened criminals.
My same friend who was talking to me about this sent me a link to an article that he read. Mm-hmm. He lives in Los Angeles. And some article in some local newspaper, like not the Times or anything, but some local thing he read, some blog, was saying that they became aware there in California that people in Nevada are looking to push a law that will have like some kind of breathalyzer or some kind of instant, what's the word I'm looking for? The ability to know if you've smoked within the past few hours or not.
Sure. In order to determine intoxication. You're looking for an active metabolite test that will be administrable by the roadside. But
in theory.
In theory, but I saw a story in the RJ a couple of days back, couple of them actually, that the DA's office is now scrambling because hundreds of convictions here in Clark County were based on roadside drug tests
that have been proven faulty.
It was $2 test.
Oh yeah,
it was absolutely unreliable.
You see, and this is the kind of nonsense I'm talking about. I was online reading that article, and these people commenting under the thread are just like, oh, you drug dealers knew what you're getting into. It's like, did you even read the article? These people are guilty of nothing.
Right.
They're guilty of nothing, and still you choose to throw them under the bus just because a guy with a badge that did some push-ups in Freedom Park for a few weeks said he's a bad guy. Mm-hmm. That's not okay with me. You know, what happened to the actual integrity of the criminal justice system, so I was led to believe throughout the course of my lifetime. And what I remember hearing when I was a little kid was, it's better that 100 guilty men walk free rather than one innocent man go to prison for any length of time, because our preservation of freedom is so valued in this country that we would never, ever compromise that. And that's a bunch of horseshit. We haven't seen that. And I'm not so prepared to turn over all of Nevada's citizens' ability to be screened under these impromptu tests until the validity is proven. And not proven, but actually scientifically proven, not just a police lobbyist saying this is a good thing. Like, I want to see the science, independent science, before we make this law. I'm still under the assumption that you should have to prove impairment before you take someone's freedom away, whether it's prescription narcotics, whether it's like an opioid or a Xanax or for your PTSD or whatever you're taking for whatever reason. There needs to be more of a blanket idea about this, you know, just because, like, they're trying to lop it in like alcohol. It doesn't exactly work like alcohol.
And that's exactly what this article is trying to do, because police sergeant John David, who runs the DUI program with the LBMPD, said that you can't do it when you're driving, just like alcohol, right? And he's saying that pot is just like alcohol in the way that it deteriorates your ability to operate a motor vehicle. Now, standard field sobriety tests, however, including the walk and turn, one leg stand, and nose test, are effective tools for determining impairment for both alcohol and marijuana, the article states. Now, let's give legal workshop 30 seconds. If a police officer ever asks you to take a field sobriety test and you agree to take it, you have just failed the police sobriety field test. It is a completely subjective test. The officer gets to determine whether he thinks you are incapacitated or intoxicated just due to your responses. So you have a legal right to not take the field sobriety test. And as I said, the way you fail it is to take it. So protect your rights if you're in that situation, and just politely decline. And you may go on to another step, but you will just save yourself a little hard time with that one. So anyway, getting back to this article here. It says that rough numbers from Metro's traffic units showed that about 997 drugged driving arrests occurred in 2016. And more than half of the cases were marijuana cases. And so 997, that's something on the order of a little less than 20 a week. You know.
It's a lot.
Yeah. You know, it is. Sergeant David said that some Metro officers are rushing to get a 16-hour training course called ARIDE, which is the Advanced Roadside Impairment Driving Enforcement Program, and it will teach them to discern signs associated with common drug groups and general signs of impairment. So the police are rushing out there. You know, they fought.
That's
like
funny.
That.
I don't remember. I don't remember the cannabis community being approached about these new training procedures or having them reach out to patients or any of these groups saying, hey, you know, we know you guys are the potential recipients of these new laws that were or policies that were putting in place. Any input on this, considering you guys are here? If it was me, I'd like to hold a patients and police forum with this sergeant John David, and have all of these patients explain to them, look, you know, we've been doing this for a long period of time and we've been fighting you. We need to come to a consensus because you're, you know, stoking a wedge between the people who protect us and the people who are supposed to be protected.
But you're using the word patients here, and now they're talking about the larger recreation.
Oh, I'm sorry. You know, I'm so used to saying patients. Right.
They're trying to equate drunk driving, buzz driving, however you want to determine the two of them. But what gets me in the RJ here is we know that this is a paper that turned on a dime when Sheldon Adelson bought it and has been prohibitionist since. What gets me is how they insinuate things as facts, which are not the case. And this, to me, is not good journalism. The article says, alcohol is a fairly straightforward drug. The AAA study says that there is scientific evidence of impairment in virtually all drivers who reach the 0.08 blood level threshold for intoxication. And the article then says, most responsible drivers know how to make informed choices about alcohol impairment thanks to decades of research and public education.
That's why we never have any DUIs here in Vegas, right?
Yeah, that's why you don't see lawyers in advertising
for DUIs. Or you don't see our freeway exits tagged with cars drunk, smashing into them all the time. That never, ever happens.
Yep. And, you know, the idea that, you know, most responsible drivers know how to make these informed choices. Well, I would say, okay, if you're going to go throw that little canard out, then you would have to include cannabis drivers as being responsible there as well, because they have had decades of police persecution and scrutiny with everything that they're doing. And so those people had to be extra cautious when they were out on the road. And in fact, if you do look at studies from around the world, I'm familiar with some from Britain and New Zealand, they show that people who are under the influence of cannabis are actually safer drivers. They slow down, they're aware of their impairment. And so, you know, and once again, as I've said before on the show, I'm not saying anyone should drive under the influence of anything.
It goes even worse than that. The stereotyping and things like that. Like, have you ever heard of an alcoholic car being stereotyped? What kind of car do alcoholics drive?
One with four wheels?
Well, what kind of cars do stoners drive? Volkswagen bus with the long-haired guy?
With Grateful Dead stickers on the
back.
Yeah,
if you have certain stickers on your car, or if you drive a certain type of vehicle, or if you have, like, a piece, you know what I mean? Oh, you know, maybe you're a doper.
Yep. That's and it's, you see, it's that term doper which sticks with the law enforcement community and has since the 1950s, and that mindset has never changed. But it's not helped when you have newspapers that are supposed to be
the largest newspaper representing 2 million citizens here.
Exactly. It says here in the article, it takes a little while for a drink to reach your bloodstream and then your brain.
Okay.
But marijuana, when smoked, reaches your brain immediately and doesn't clear out for a long time.
Okay, so with that argument, if I was to get into my car, like, I'm just going to have one more drink and go from the bar. I have a shot and I roll out because I have somewhere to be. If I get pulled over 5 seconds after that just because they see me leaving the bar, that alcohol is going to be fresh on my breath and I'm going to blow way higher than I would have. Mm-hmm. Should that be taken into account? You know, I'm not exactly sure where he wants to go with that.
Well, I don't know either. But you see, the idea that you have something where they say, okay, alcohol takes a little while to reach your bloodstream and then your brain. Okay, that's it. Done talking about alcohol. Pot, on the other hand, hits it immediately and doesn't leave for a long time. They don't say anything in this statement that the sergeant makes about the fact that alcohol stays in your bloodstream for a while as well.
Yeah, it takes
and
an hour to metabolize per drink.
From studious research that I did in my student days at college, that I have woken up with alcohol hangovers and still been drunk, you know, hours later.
Absolutely.
And it never happened with cannabis. I would never wake up still being high.
Let me think about it.
Okay, and so, you know, the idea that they're presenting half truths, and we talked about this earlier in the autumn with Joe Bresny about how the prohibitionist side will go out there and give half truths and outright lies, as we read a number of them in the lead up to the election, and you know, we just see more of this, and you just hate to see it in Nevada's paper of record. So what else do we have from this article? Well, they're now talking about here's an interesting piece. In Oakland, a company called Hound Labs has developed a marijuana breath test that could distinguish recent use from chronic use.
How?
I don't get that at all. I mean, if you're a chronic user, by definition, you will have had recent use. I just don't see any way around that. And according to the police, if you are a recent user, you're a chronic user. If according to the police, if you are a medical marijuana patient and they go into your house and you have a firearm, you're in violation of the laws against firearm possession because you are addicted to marijuana, according to the police.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It's crazy stuff. So the co-founder, Jenny Lin, said that the device detects marijuana in the breath for 6 hours after use. I got to say, you know, my wife is really good at that, too. I can take one little half of a hit someplace, and she's like, you did it. And so if this is as sensitive as she is, it's going to work really well.
That's hilarious.
But
just take her around with them.
That's great.
Yeah. Good side job. But the interesting, so this was in the RJ. That was on New Year's Day. But just 3 days before, on December 28th, they posted another article, which was not written by one of their staff, but they picked it up from the Reuters news agency. And author Ronnie Cohen wrote that legalization of medical marijuana is not linked with increased traffic fatalities, a new study finds. In some states, in fact, the number of people killed in traffic accidents dropped after medical marijuana laws were enacted. So instead of seeing an increase in fatalities, we saw a reduction, which was totally unexpected, said Julian Santaella Tenorio, the study's lead author and a doctoral student at Columbia University's School of Public Health. And so... I got to stop here and say, okay, instead of seeing an increase in fatalities, we saw a reduction, which was totally unexpected. Boy, this is almost word for word what we talked about a couple of weeks ago with Dr. Nora Valco of the National Institute of Drug Abuse when they looked and saw that teen drug use, 8th grade, 12th grade and stuff, have gone down in medical marijuana states. She's, I don't understand it. We expected it would go up. You know, and the same
well,
thing.
Well, educated,
here.
Intelligent people leave room to change their minds in the on the presentation of, you know, new evidence.
And
you shouldn't
and
have
it.
Such,
these
you know.
Have such an image indelibly stamped in their mind as to cause and effect and what's going to happen here that they're just astounded when they're finding out that pot isn't the problem, the boogeyman that the government has been building it into for 75 years. So, what a surprise. Deaths dropped 11% on average in states that legalized medical marijuana, researchers discovered after analyzing 1.2 million traffic fatalities nationwide from 1985 through 2014. So that's actually a pretty big sample.
It is.
You're talking about 30 years. You're talking about over a million people. So sometimes they'll do a study and they'll do it with 5 people or 20 people, and you can't really...
Yeah.
Judge the reliability. But now you're talking a million plus people over 30 years. That's significant. And the idea that they don't go into why this could possibly have happened, they're saying, though, that this is interesting, the decrease in traffic fatalities was particularly striking at 12%. In 25 to 44-year-olds, an age group with a large percentage of medical marijuana users, these mirror the findings of another study of data from 19 states, which was published in 2013 in the Journal of Law and Economics, showing an 8 to 11% decrease in traffic fatalities. Now, I'm trying to, as I read this article and as I'm looking at this, I'm trying to figure out why that could be. On the one hand, as we're talking about people being aware that they are under the influence, they do slow down. So if you have a slower rate of speed, you're going to have less fatalities. I'm not really sure, but there's more to the story. But the point that I wanted to make with this, Perry, is that within 3 days in the same newspaper, you have an article of fact coming out with a 30-year study of a million people saying, you know, marijuana is not causing traffic fatalities. And then 3 days later, you've got our local writer.
A traditional fear-mongering prohibitionist,
exactly.
Classic textbook, opinionated article.
You got it. You know. So, well, this is our RJ. We report, you decide. No, somebody else took that, I think. Okay, I'm going to check into that. We're going to come right back after this quick commercial break.
My name is Janine Evans, and I am the office manager at Getting Legal, and we help people get their medical marijuana cards. Anyone can be approved for a medical marijuana card as long as they have a pre-existing medical condition. The medical conditions recognized in Nevada include severe pain, severe nausea, muscle spasms, seizures, glaucoma, cancer, HIV or AIDS, and post-traumatic stress disorder. Our staff helps every patient determine before they come in for a visit whether or not they will qualify. We take care of the whole process of getting a medical marijuana card from the state of Nevada from start to finish. Our services include paperwork processing, a physician's visit, notary services. All of our patients pick up their approval letters right here in our office. We make it fast, simple, and easy. During your consultation, we will discuss different products available at the dispensaries, such as edibles, lotions, and concentrates. We will also discuss different ways to medicate, such as smoking or vaporizing. You will receive a separate identification card identifying you as a medical marijuana patient. This is used to enter the dispensaries and only to enter the dispensaries. Every veteran receives a discount off of the full price of their card. We also offer discounts to anyone working within the medical marijuana industry. All you need to do is call 702-979-9999, and a member of our friendly staff will help you schedule an appointment.
Welcome back to the Nevada Cannabis News Hour. Today we are here to talk about another story out of California, right?
We'll start off with this as we're moving a little beyond California, beyond Nevada.
Apparently, now that Prop 64 is passed in California, there are certain senators and lawmakers who are apparently concerned that the marijuana DUI open container bill or language doesn't go far enough. They're kind of suggesting that it's, even though it's illegal to have an open container of marijuana in the car, it's somehow legal to consume while in a car, either smoking a joint or eating a brownie or things like that. So they
essentially driving while high.
Yeah. They proposed Senate Bill 65, which would close what they call a dangerous loophole. It'll be consistent with the alcohol laws in the state of California, so they say. But it seems very redundant to me, considering, like you said, driving while high has never been legal. We've never condoned it. We've never advocated for it. The proponents of the Prop 64, of course, would never want that language inserted. And
it would never have passed.
It seems as though this is one of those feel-good bills that we see a lot. You know, people want to pass it so they can feel good about what they did and pass this common sense change, this law that should obviously be here. Yeah. But for me, it seems just like a waste of time. If they really want to, if Senator Hill is so concerned with the safety of his fellow Californians, he should work with his other representatives to draft a law that would actually protect them concerning these bills rather than just close a non-existent loophole.
And especially since this is something where, as we've said, studies have shown that people are aware of their impairment and make adjustment for it, and that's not even taking into account people who have the common sense to say, well, I've had too much to drink, or oh, I've had too much to smoke right now, and so I'm not going to drive for a while. And I do believe, though, that if we sat down and I'm knocking down highballs and you're puffing on a pipe, that at the end of that, you're going to recover and be able to drive more quickly than I would be able to drive.
Oh, absolutely. I would agree with that, no doubt about it.
And so what these lawmakers are doing is they're saying that the new law, which legalized pot in California, only makes it illegal to have a container of marijuana in a car. I've never driven down the street, you know, having an open container of pot.
I was thinking the same thing. It's like, I'm not in that big of a hurry to get it open and smell it. You know what I mean? I don't understand.
Yeah, it totally doesn't make sense. It just presupposes,
what about passengers?
That it wasn't illegal to be under the influence before.
What about passengers?
Way of getting their name.
If I'm driving, can my passengers smoke?
No, because an open container, an alcohol container in the passenger compartment of the vehicle, doesn't matter who has it. So they're saying that this just brings pot into line with alcohol.
Okay.
But, you know, I think it's just absurd. It was already.
Sense. Yeah, we'll see.
You know. If it's wrapped in paper, is that an open container?
That's a good point. If you got a dovetail joint, you know, you're pretty well sealed.
That's pretty funny.
So let's see, to cover a little bit of that we've covered before in past shows, just to give you an update, we've talked about Governor Charlie Baker in Massachusetts, who was one of the prohibitionist anti on their question for legalization. Of course, legalization did pass in Massachusetts, and now Governor Baker has signed a measure this past Friday that delays the opening of marijuana retail outlets by 6 months in the state. Now, groups of protesters have gathered outside the state house to protest this move, and I don't know what that's going to accomplish. He's already signed this. I don't expect that he's going to be changing his mind. The Massachusetts Cannabis Reform Coalition said that they were, and I quote, appalled at this arrogant and cowardly move, whose effect it will be to give the black market another six-month monopoly, end quote. Oh, that's well said, and I agree. Because all they're going to do, especially, they've legalized it. Anybody in the state can possess it. If you're not giving people a legitimate place to go get it, they're going to find it just like they've been doing for 70 years.
You just ramped up the black market business.
Absolutely,
big time,
because now it's legal, but there's no retail place to buy it.
The pressure feels off for the consumers.
Absolutely, absolutely. So, you know, this is just, once again, a knee-jerk reaction from a prohibitionist politician who's out of touch with what the American, in this case, Massachusetts population wants, and they're just going off on their own merry way. Mm-hmm. So enough with Governor Baker. Let's see. Rhode Island, which is right next door to Massachusetts, is actually being more progressive on this issue, and they've just signed a new law, which took effect on the 1st, that will allow people in Rhode Island to obtain a license to grow hemp for oil, clothing, fiber, food, and other commercial products. And lawmakers proposed this bill initially to allow members of the Narragansett Indian tribe to cultivate hemp, but the language was expanded to include any licensed grower. And okay, I can see that. You want equal protection under the law, and that equal protection under the law, I think, is what's ultimately going to save us in Nevada with our own rights to grow. And so the United States currently imports about $500 million of hemp annually from other countries such as China, Canada, and the like, but the plant remains illegal for most farmers to grow. Now, what happened here in Rhode Island is they signed on an authorization by the state to allow the state to participate in an investigational hemp program, which was signed in the Farm Bill of 2014 by President Obama. And this was a bill that had bipartisan support, which allows pilot projects, whether to be grown individually or through a university or other educational facility. And so Rhode Island is now just taking advantage of that, as well as a number of other states. Nevada does have such a program, but it's good to see them expanding it, because if we're buying $500 million a year hemp seed from Canada and China, you know, let's make American hemp great again.
No doubt about it.
And
absolutely.
By all means, let's have domestic consumption with that. What else do we see here?
What do you got over there? Florida.
Okay.
Well, up in Oregon, our border state, there are new rules affecting recreational cannabis retailers that will take effect yesterday. Last Saturday was the end of limited retail sales from the Oregon Health Authority, which began in October 2015 following the passage of Measure 91. Recreational sales and licenses will be governed by the Oregon Liquor Control Commission starting yesterday. Medical dispensaries that wanted to continue selling recreational are working to beat a Sunday deadline to pay fees and file applications. They're receiving hundreds of applications throughout the state. You know, there are places already looking to reopen under the new recreational laws. They've been extremely fast with their processing. Some of the pre-existing medical retailers are saying they're rolling it over real quick.
Yes.
Like this lady applied and she's already to open her second location as of yesterday.
Wow.
So she's ready to roll. It seems like Oregon's ready. Hopefully the transition is nice and smooth, because they've caught a lot of shit for getting rid of the medical.
But, and we'll see how it goes. with Oregon, why that is relevant here in Nevada is we're going to have something similar in our own rollout. In that, up until the first, it was the health division essentially in Oregon that was running the program. Now they've turned it over to the state liquor board. So we're going to have the similar a similar thing crafted in the legislature this spring, whereas the Division of Health will hold on for 18 months or as much as necessary of that time period to oversee recreational sales through current MMEs while the rules are being written by the Department of Taxation, which is going to oversee our rec program, and they will take over once those regulations are complete and have been reviewed and publicly commented. So it's good to see where Oregon is going on this and the fact that they're having a smooth transition, because that points that we're going to be able to do much the same thing.
Absolutely.
Given that Senator Siegerblom and others have said that we have modeled our program a lot after Oregon. So as we're looking to these other states for guidance, this shows that it can be an easy path.
I certainly hope so.
One does.
I hope so.
So in the state of Florida, we talked about Florida being a state which in the last cycle had their vote denied, even though they had 57%. They won this year by 70%. And so in Florida, one of their senior senators, one of their most influential state senators, is saying that the state should pay for medical marijuana research. And this is Senator Bill Galvano, and he said, we need to know more, and he wants the state to pay. He said, we're relying on anecdotal evidence. We have a dearth of research from the feds for a variety of reasons, and it's important for us to understand both the benefits and potential hazards of this plant and drug as we go forward. And so he's sending it to a center at the University of South Florida is where he expects this research would take place. And I think it's a great idea. I mean, we have done we, as activists, as advocates, as patients, have done so much research on this and brought research to whatever official sources we can over the years. And you still get the DEA routinely saying, oh, there's not enough research here. You know, marijuana doesn't have any proven medical benefits. So, you know, if we have state universities actually starting to research this, maybe we can move towards chipping away that DEA ban.
No doubt. It gives it an air of legitimacy also, you know what I mean? If these state senators are pushing for the universities in their various districts to conduct this research, it doesn't get any more legit than that, so we'll see how it goes.
We will, and so we have great hopes that Florida is going to be able to move this into being very quickly, because then we can use that in other states as a as an incentive. Here in Nevada, of course, we have an educational component to the medical marijuana law, and it was crafted back in 2001. And the University of Nevada at Reno is in charge of this program, and they were supposed to set up a research program about this, and
it never came to fruition.
And it's like every 3 months they go up before a legislative committee and they say, oh yeah, about that program, yep, it's still there, we're still looking at it. And that's essentially what they do. Back in 2010, when numerous dispensaries, including my own, opened up, we had gathered a bunch of patient data and tried to turn it over to the State Division of Health so they could start building a database of patient reports, and they didn't want to touch it. They didn't want anything to do with it. It's the way it goes.
Well done. We do the research for you. You throw it in our face.
It doesn't matter. And, you know, you think we're moving ahead on these things, and in many ways we are. But at the same time, it seems like we're, you know,
two steps forward, three steps back.
Yeah, exactly that. Because, I mean, you look at the situation that we're in general right now, and we've got legalization sweeping the land.
Oh,
we've got medical marijuana sweeping the land, and yet we've elected an administration that is every bit as prohibitionist and obstructive as any in recent memory on the drug war, as any since the drug war has started. And this does not just happen only on the Republican side and only on that, you know, the social evangelical side.
I was going to say, you know, the Obama administration hasn't exactly been...
They weren't a big friend.
No, the saviors that everyone expected. You know, everyone kind of just kind of ignores and gives them a pass and wants to throw the finger at the Republicans who haven't even gotten in yet.
President Obama, I mean, you know. I know you're listening. I know you're a midnight toker and you know, can't really come out and say anything about that, but you have 18 days left where you can deschedule cannabis completely and kick the legs out from under Jeff Sessions and Mike Pence. Please consider. So anyway, we have another senator, a Democratic Senator Joe Manchin of West Virginia, who is one of the country's most conservative Democratic senators, without a doubt. He's calling for a new war on drugs.
Well, he's from West Virginia, right?
So well, yes, you know. Because he's from West Virginia, and in fact, West Virginia has a huge opioid epidemic, But to show you how he's clueless on these things, Senator Manchin said, and I quote, "They got started out as a kid smoking occasional, what we call recreational marijuana. From there, it led into prescriptions, taking out their parents' or grandparents' medicine cabinet and become a cool kid. Then it turned into where they were hooked. Now heroin comes on. Now the fentanyl comes on."
Wow. I love how he just has this magical insight into the minds of millions and millions of West Virginians.
Oh, dude knows it all.
That's pretty funny. Actually, it's not funny because this guy is a very serious policymaker.
Because what he could do is he could be responsible for putting more people into jail for use of a plant.
My grandfather's from West Virginia. I got a lot of friends and family from that area, and I understand their suffering and their struggles. I don't want to see, you know, people of mine go through that
but
what we need to do...
I mean, they have an opioid crisis, and according to this article, it says deaths from opioid pills and heroin now exceed automotive and firearm fatalities, nearly 33,000 per year, and this is nationwide, with nearly half of those deaths coming from prescription opioids, such as hydrocodone and oxycodone, and, you know...
This Manchin is just, like, throwing Hail Marys all over the place. He's just like, oh, it's the prescription drugs, and it's pot, and it's the parents,
it's everything. His people are dying, he wants to do something, and the thing is buried in here, it says the drug firms poured 780 million painkillers into West Virginia amid the rise of overdoses. That is 750 million pills into that small state.
How many people live in West Virginia? It doesn't say in the article, but
I don't think it's more than a couple of million people. It's not a big state. So he's worried about the fact that his people are addicted. He's just making that, he's bought hook, line, and sinker into that prohibitionist argument that pot is a gateway drug. And as we've talked on this program, if pot is a gateway with opioid dependency, it is the gateway out of that dependency, not into it. And, you know, it's unfortunate that this man's a U.S. senator, and he's going to go hand in glove with the Trump administration on this one. So I don't know what to tell you on that one. If you guys out in West Virginia,
bipartisan
do
support.
Something. Yeah, bipartisan support. Okay, we're going to take another quick commercial break. We'll be right back.
My name is Armin Imanijan. I work with Essence Cannabis Dispensaries. We have 3 dispensaries and they're all located in Las Vegas. We have the only dispensary on the Las Vegas Strip, which is located at 2307 Las Vegas Boulevard South on the corner of Sahara and Las Vegas Boulevard. I've been with Essence since Q1 of 2014. I'm the founder and one of the owners of the company. I've been involved in the marijuana industry just over 2 years. And my background is actually in gaming. I was vice president of casino marketing and vice president of casino operations at the Tropicana Hotel and Casino for 6 years on the Las Vegas Strip. The Strip dispensary is open from 10 a.m. to midnight 7 days a week. There's ample amount of parking just behind the dispensary. The way I classify Essence is not to be defined by a certain special or a certain promotion. We have specials on 4th of July, 7/10, 4/20, Labor Day, and they're very strong and very aggressive specials. We're really excited to put them out for patients, but that's not what defines us, and that's not what we want patients to come in for. We want patients to come in because we have the widest selection of the highest quality cannabis on the market at the fairest price with an unmatched experience. It's really important to us that we create an emotional connection with the patient, and that's what keeps them coming back.
Welcome back to the Cannabis News Hour on www.dbtv.com. All right, we have, as we're looking and expanding out beyond the world, or into the world, I should say, we see that in the United Kingdom, they have now classified marijuana-based products as a medicine. And this comes out of the International Business Times. And it says here that people in the UK will soon be able to use cannabis-based products containing the plant's medicinal component, cannabidiol, or CBD, according to reports. Now, the Medicine and Healthcare Products Regulatory Agency classified CBD as a medicine in the UK this past Tuesday. Great.
So one DEA on one side of the pond says it's good to go.
That's exactly where we're going to the next story. Right?
Oh,
so in England, they've declared CBD is medicine. And the director of their inspection enforcement told Sky News that the department ruled that CBD is a medicine after reviewing several manufacturing companies that made overt medicinal claims about products. So they decided to review it and see whether this stuff was valid or not. And so now that they have classified it as a medicine, they plan to allow manufacturers to produce products and conduct a research proving the safety, quality, and effectiveness of the plant. So by legalizing CBD as a form of medicine, the department was expecting that to cut that they would cut down on an online black market. And in fact, you saw when we went to the marijuana business conference and or at Champs that there are companies which are selling CBD oils and shipping to all 50 states.
Absolutely.
And because they know it's medicine, it's an anti-inflammatory, it's got some potential anti-tumor properties. It's just a crucial part, and it's also non-psychoactive. It does not get you high at all. And CBD is the active cannabinoid in the Charlotte's Web strain, for example, which reduces the seizures that these kids are having. So over in England, they've gone ahead and they've said, yep, you know, that's a medicine. It makes sense. That's good.
Meanwhile,
back in Washington, D.C., the land of Oz, the DEA just banned CBD, and so here's why. And this comes from GreenRushDaily.com, with Ab Hanna being the author, and the legality of CBD is no longer in the gray area. In fact, the DEA has just banned CBD, cementing its place on the list of Schedule I substances. You know, it will not get you high, as I just said. It does stop seizures. It stops other debilitating conditions, and you know, so why are they doing this? Well, the DEA has given the reason that the U.S. is complying with international drug control treaties that we forced down the throat of the U.N. You know, 50 years ago.
I have a hard time believing that the CBD fits under that drug control.
Hard time believing that the right. The right-wing elements of the government, which are coming into play now, could give one shit about UN treaties and the like. You know?
Well, it's all good when it fits their policy on a given day.
Yes.
You know, to hell with the UN 99 days out of 100. We don't want UN here telling us what to do with our guns or basically anything else.
Very true.
With drugs, you know, we should listen to you guys because obviously – you know, this fits our conservative policy.
Absolutely, here we are. So they're saying that this treaty that we forced through the UN is the reason we can't change our own drug policy.
The UN that we should supposedly get out of. The UN that we should people get out. That are pushing
exactly.
this. Yeah.
And the DEA claims that there are small amounts of cannabinoids in every CBD extract, and they claim that this is another reason to keep CBD on schedule.
There's small amounts of bullshit in every one of their statements. Should we get rid of them?
I don't know. I think it's pretty large amounts, but that's very good. The thing is, you know, that's the That's how they legitimize spending tens of millions of dollars each summer from Indiana to Kentucky and wherever to take people, to take ditch weed that I read that you have to smoke a telephone pole-sized joint in order to get high off of them. But they're saying, oh, it has some trace amount. And that's what they're saying here, that every bit of CBD is going to have some trace amount of THC in it somewhere. And so that's why they've got to, hey, those kids who went from 300 seizures a week down to a seizure a month,
to hell
screw
with them.
You. Have the seizures.
How do we know you're not just doing it to get high?
Just to get high on this stuff.
As the child is rolling around on the floor, foaming at the mouth.
But the DEA rep said that, however, even if it were possible to produce from the cannabis plant an extract that contained only CBD and no other cannabinoids, such an extract would fall within the new drug code. So they say, we don't care if it's getting you high or not. We see pot as a big problem, and this is part of that, so we're going to go full force after it. And we can do this because we know we have a new guy coming into DOJ and a new guy in the vice president's seat coming in 3 weeks who are going to support them fully in this. So it's just, it's terrible. And, you know, we're just about to go, and I just want to tell you, just as we do, that as I was coming on the air, I saw two quick stories. One is that the NAACP down in Alabama is now occupying Jeff Sessions' district office down there, and they say they're not going to leave until his nomination as Attorney General is withdrawn or till they're arrested. Any idea on which side you'd like to bet on? And secondly, a group of 1,100 law professors and academicians have sent an open letter now decrying that Jeff Sessions would be an awful, awful choice for U.S. Attorney General. So I'd suggest write to your senators, call them, and share that opinion with them.
All right, find somebody else.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, besides that, there's not really, we covered our bases. It's been a great New Year holiday. There was a wonderful holiday here in Nevada with a celebration of the passage of Question 2.
Yes.
We held a New Year's weed party at the Cannabis Chapel on Las Vegas Boulevard and Charleston. And thank you so much to the owners and operators there for donating the space to us to allow us to participate and have the celebration. We had a nice little turnout, good little party, very mellow,
we have
very
low key. A photo of the group to show you, and this will be the first one. Next year is going to be bigger and better, but it was a historical moment where people who were lighting up at 11:59 were criminals in the state of Nevada, and a little over a minute later they were just typical ordinary citizens enjoying their liberties here.
Let freedom ring.
Indeed. So thanks again for sticking with us, and we will see you next time on the Cannabis News Hour.